Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Zwift Power Points broadcast of the 3R Wahoo Ride Real Race Series, race number 2. We are out on the Innsbruck course with UCI Short Lap. It's going to be a lot of climbing. I'm Nathan Garrett. Next to me, virtually, is Dave Toll. And we've got quite the series starting up here. Last week was probably one of the most exciting races on the Seaside Sprint. Mike Davis taking down the sprint yet last week. It was pretty fun to watch, and I think this week, a little bit different, though. Not setting up so much for a sprint, I think, with a lot of climbing out here today, Dave.
There we go. So I have to say, Nathan, you're 100% right. It's going to be a decidedly different event today. I'm expecting our winner to finish alone. That's pretty rare. You know what? Again, let's take a look at that course, actually. It's going to be a small group. Maybe some riders chase back on after what's going to be a devastating climb today. Nathan, I am so stoked. Here we go again. It has really been amazing to be a part of this just global phenomenon that's happening on Zwift. So, riders, let's get ready to hit out. We got a monster climb ahead of us today. Nathan, let's talk about that climb.
Yeah, so the climb, it's going to be probably about a 20-minute, maybe a little less than 20 minutes or so. And, you know, full on as far as 8 to 10% gradient throughout of it. It's about 46 seconds to the start of the race here. And we've got riders chatting away about how painful it is going to be out here today. So, you know, essentially, you've got an all-out FTP effort is what you end up having here day. Essentially, Innsbruck KOM, only 24 kilometers in total, but because of that climb in the middle of this here with the reality of the gradients, I think we get up to about maximum gradient on there looks to be about somewhere pushing 10% as you get into the actual villages out there out on the Innsbruck course. Let's take as we get into the race here, let's just take a quick look though at the GC standings as they do stand out here. Mike Davis obviously walking away with that sprint just ahead of Holden Camus. Now that is going to be only, you know, the difference in GC there is less than a second though between almost all of the top two riders, and then the rest of the riders they're about 1 second, you know, rounding all the way out to Brett Boniface there in 10th place. Brian Hodges, top three, all Americans, which is interesting to see. That's not something you usually see with these European racings, actually. So let's go ahead and jump into the racing, though, as they do jump out on course. But interesting to see where these standings are at this point, as it's not usually that way in the world of Zwift racing, actually.
All right. Well, we're going to jump right in here. This is the Innsbruck course that we're racing on. This was the 2018 World Road Championships. I really remember this one, Nathan, for that Mike Woods ride, the Canadian who ended up with the bronze medal, but obviously Alejandro Valverde was the winner that day. So as we take a look here, as Nathan talks about that climb, interesting to note, FTP, that test is typically done in a 20-minute interval. So they're going to probably see some new FTPs being set out here today. Nathan, as they have a really flat run up right now, how hard do you expect them to go? I mean, a little easier than usual because of the climb, Nathan, or does that not change anything?
I think up front, I think, you know, the reality of the way that people race out on Zwift, they're going to want to put a little bit of sting in the legs, I think, up front. We are looking here. It looks like a heel heel from Cryogen coming out of South Africa, but there is a rider I definitely want to mention here. Hillkind Champion, I think he is going to, of the UK, he is going to be, I think, a little bit looking for some revenge, actually, I think, because this past week I watched Ed Laverick have a lit on this specific course, actually, on this climb, have a couple of technical issues, and I think he's coming back for revenge today. I've been watching out for Ed Laverick today. That's my call out. He is going to hit this climb, I think, like no other, full on. And this is, of course, and you know, I've watched him a lot of times recently on some of his YouTube streams. He's streaming most likely right now over on YouTube. And I think
there he is.
I think the reality is that in these bigger sprint courses, he ends up 20th, 15th. This is a guy who's got an FTP pushing and plus almost up to 6 watts per kilogram. I mean, I think today is his day. You know, he's going to sit in. He's going to try and stay as quiet as possible for the beginning of the race. And then I think it's going to be everything you got to the top and try and break things apart. Now, the reality is that they hit the climb. And then after the climb, there's still a good, it's only the about 11K
way.
Mark. Yeah, you're at the 11K yeah. mark, and you still got about 13K to go as we're already heading out toward this climb. So it's everything to the top. Staying alone from there on out, I think we're going to have a group of like 5 to 10 riders actually over the top.
That would be ideal, to tell you the truth. If you want to win this race, you don't want to go over the top of that climb alone, because there's going to be a group of guys behind you that'll nail you back. That's just the reality of the depth, the quality of riders that we have in this field. Nathan, there's so much to talk about as we send them out on course. You mentioning Ed Laverick, that was the last thing in the world that a lot of these riders wanted to hear, that Laverick is coming in not only motivated, but I'd even say hyper-motivated. So, I mean, I want to mention Stefan Kirchmeier. He's from Austria. This man is a beast, and watch out for him today. Again, that's the Austrian rider who comes in as one of our top ranked here on Zwift Power. You can go find this data on Zwift Power yourself. Brian Hodges of the Evo bike team is the top ranked American and the top ranked rider coming into this race. The Canadian, who you should be familiar with, Brett Boniface, if you've been watching for the last couple of months, he is definitely one of the OG Zwifters that has retained. It shows you how the knowledge that he has makes a big difference. It's not just the engine. And then here's the superstar in real life, Nathan, that we'll be watching for again today. I am really curious to see how Christopher McGlinchey out of Northern Ireland does. He is absolutely going to be a wild card. Holden Camo, who a really good article in Velo News about him. He at times has been the top ranked rider in the Zwift world. This platform has suited him very well. So getting a look at some of the top riders to watch here. Eda Friere is here today, Nathan. Watch out for the Mexican rider. He should be excellent on this climb. So here we go. This is going to be a lot of fun. Expect the Donnybrook coming up. They're rolling right now. The flat sector, the climb really begins, I'm going to say, at 4K in. So a couple 100 meters here, Nathan. The road starts to tilt up.
Yeah, we are at 4% gradient, but we're not going to get into the business end of this climb for a little while. Now we do see Kirchmeier now making his way to the front here. We're still looking at Holden Camus there coming from the Cyrus TPC, the Pros Closet. We actually saw a lot of Instagram posts popping up out there with a lot of new bikes heading their way, actually, as they just picked up that new sponsor. It's good to see the Pros Closet supporting this esports team out there, and they're going to be on their Cyrus trainers, it looks like, here with Holden here sitting steady now, 31st place, not making any serious moves. I do see a Polish rider, though, up toward the front here. We'll have to wait and see if there's some moves actually happen early on, as let's see if we can get an idea of who it is that is starting to push the pace already, and
here
that
we go.
Is going to be Kirkmeyer's following a wheel here, but it's going to be Paxopko here, coming from the Zwift Poland team, actually being followed very closely as George Mills Keeling. Actually, I got some messages actually coming from Mills Keeling's dad the other day saying, "Hey, look in the stream, looking to see what we can do in the Zwift world, and all about pressing the pedals and getting the results out here." Dan Fleeman not following up, also from Cyrus the Pro's Closet. McGlinchey's there as well, who you had mentioned. Yeah. Look at all the verified batches making the way to the front here. Very cool to see. This is the already starting at a 5% gradient here, but this Polish rider here, 6.3 watts per kilogram, looking to make an early dent, it looks like.
Yeah, here we go. I mean, you can just feel it now. The accelerator has been sort of hovering above the floorboard, but it has just been pushed down as this group is going to look at how long the group is strung out all the way around that switchback here. And I mean, those guys are still looking at tiny little gaps back here. So you can show you they eased into this one a little more than normal, but it was become up on 5K. The gradient starting to increase. We ratcheted up 6% right now on this part of the climb. Nathan, as you said, it gets very steep here in a little bit. That's where we'll start to see riders doing exactly this. Pozopko, very impressive as we start to get the my eyes first time picking up data on that rider out of Poland. Nathan, good catch. And as you mentioned, Ed Laverick up here, McGlinchey, these guys, the usual heads of state, seem to find their position in the front of the pack, but they're not throwing all their chips in the middle of the table yet. We got a long way to go. As you mentioned, it's going to be about 20 minutes of pure suffering on this climb. When you talk about that 6 watts per kilo number, Nathan, I think that was Ed Laverick that you were talking about a little bit earlier in this race. That's very, very close to that number that you'd look at to be climbing in the front group in the Tour de France on a mountain day. That is the very, very elite. Dan Fleeman is a man who would know that. He's a longtime World Tour, Pro Tour rider, representing the United Kingdom at the very highest level. And there he is taking a big dig. Still, though, Nathan, surprisingly, not that much damage being done yet. Almost 8 minutes in, and it shows you, well, little splits starting to happen here. It's on, no doubt about it, but it's not on like Donkey Kong yet.
Yeah, we do see it looks like Conte here from Team ZF Freya. They're right in that little gap that's starting to open up there. Tyree there from Primera there as well. But the current series leader, Mike Davis, we're looking at right here. Can he hold on? And I saw him making, I think I saw some emojis coming from Davis with some crying tears because he is pure sprinter. That's how he got away and got the jump on the rest of the field and won the first round here. Davis now 7.3 watts per kilogram, as you can see, trying to hold on. Coming out of SoCal, Southern California. Aaron Anderson now coming across from Z Sun. Holden Camus there now from Cyrus the Pro's Closet. He's sitting second overall currently, 1 second on the rest of the field. On a day like today, that 1 second most likely going to be, I don't know, we'll have to wait and see. You know, this kind of a climb can put so much hurt in the legs.
Yeah, I mean, I'm picking up what you're putting down, Nathan. I would expect, look at the twig getting back up into that group. I would expect that we see the GC completely turned upside down after this day is done. This is the second of 7 races that make up this awesome series. We love World Bicycle Relief, and it's really nice to see their support coming from our friends at 3R and Wahoo. I'm a Wahooligan, Nathan. So awfully happy to see those good folks involved. And look at this. Looks like we're going to start seeing selections being made left, right, and center. The man himself, Patrick Brady of the Evoke team, taking a big turn here. Okay, Nathan, we're going to have a really that's a group chasing back on with Patrick Brady.
Yeah, 33rd place currently, trying to get back on terms
here. They will.
2 seconds back. It looks like they are going to. Very difficult. Now, this is an interesting situation here. So the way this climb works, because of the 5%, the 10%, now down to 4%, 3% even, was it smart there for Brady to hold back a little bit and not make his way all the way to the front? There is a reality that sometimes, very, very rarely in Zwift racing, it does pay off to hold up just a little bit and don't put that extra energy down. Patrick Brady maybe making a smart move, maybe wasn't even making a move, maybe was just suffering. But the reality of the suffering ended up making it so that he was able to reserve a little bit of energy, perhaps. Because on the front here, the Polish rider, again, we're going to see Paxopo again on the front demolishing things right now, as you can see, and continues to press the pace as we get into these steeper gradients. 7% again. We'll be jumping up into 9-10% in just a second as we head into the village here. This is going to be a very fast climb. I think we're going to be looking at something around 17 to 18 minutes. It was absolutely flying as we do have the selection here up into the top 30 so far. We started with 150 almost racers, and we're down to, it looks like, 30 or so for the selection.
Yeah, this is definitely that OSS situation, Nathan. Only the strong survive on a climb like this. I think the name of the game might be who's the best sprinter left as we go up and over the top of that climb. You want to take some inventory and look around, Nathan. It'll be a small group, that's for sure. Might not even be a group, but it'll come back together. There's Brett Boniface having a really good ride, right into the pocket there, the sweet spot of this group. Boy, I mean, now we start to, you know, there'll be another selection here, but the guys who've made it to this point have to be feeling pretty good. I mean, they are, as you said, motoring. I mean, they're going 30 kilometers per hour right now up this climb. That is bananas. And look at this. This is going to be Turner, isn't it? The Zwift Carbon rider here, motoring off the front. It's a small gap, but it certainly sends a signal that I am feeling good today, boys. Very impressive turn of speed right here. Is okay, here comes your reaction. And it's Laverick, Nathan. You called it. Ed Laverick going to the whip right now, and he's going to start flogging himself. He's going to have a few riders to come with him. I think that might be McGlinchey getting up. It is Christopher McGlinchey getting up there. Oh, there's a very elite group, Nathan. How many riders are going to get on this train? It's leaving the station, and your race winner is going to be aboard.
Yeah, we do see Laverick responding immediately as soon as the dropout Zwift Carbon rider there makes
that's
the move. That is going to be Turner there. Mills Keeling there jumps on board as well, it looks like. Able to make it. Bradlin there from Team Sweden there. The aggressive rider early on, maybe in a little bit of trouble there in the Polish kit. Pak Zopko. Then it's going to be Dan Fleeman, Stars Pro's Closet. 1 second back. Look at this train, though. I mean, it is there. This is not Grupo Compacto at all. Barely hanging on to the wheels just in front of you. And this is the move from the dropouts. McGlinchey and Laverick as well. Those three really making moves. Now Bradlin to the front there. 6.9 watts. Almost 7 watts per kilogram. This is the move at this 10% gradient right now. The pain is real. Can the riders hang on? Friera there now from Legion trying to come across here. Cuming, Messineo there. The Poison Dart Frog, 8.9 watts per kilogram. This is a split. Conti there as well. Twig, it looks like. And this is going to be your top 18, I think, riders making it across there. Conti now 8 watts per kilogram to try and come across, trying to find a wheel. It's going to level out for a moment. There'll be a little bit of reprieve. Will they press the pedals continue, though? Let's look at the damage at the back here. Patrick Brady here back in 31st place, as you can see, as well as Neil there. We see Stretton now falling backwards there from Team Arrow, under 19 rider here. Our Anderson trying to come across here, saying, come on, boys, we got to work together. Back in 23rd place here, the aggressive rider early on from Team Poland, Twig, Conti, and then we also seen Hene from the BRT team. Now we do see the ODZ rider trying to come across, but I don't know if it's going to be happening. Jumping back on over to the main pack, though, here we go, and still the attacks are on.
Yeah, so you're going to see riders who are really going to try to use this flat section to their advantage. Well, not flat right now as the road starts to pick up. They just went through that sector that Nathan was talking about, now through the little villas here. So it's still, there's a lot of climbing still to come. I got to give Pazopko, the Polish rider, credit, hanging right in this group. He lit the fuse. And now a surprising number of guys still in this group right now. There's still a lot to come as we start to, I think everyone is going to be taking a look around. Obviously, Kirkmeyer is a man to watch. We talked about the Australian, the Irish rider McGlinchey is going to be very good on this course. Clearly, he might be the man to beat today. To tell you the truth, Nathan, here you go. Another power surge coming out the front. A move like this from Ed Laverick would dim the power grid in a small alpine village like we're climbing through right now. Ed Laverick on the attack again. This is going to have the alarm bells ringing, Nathan. Laverick, one of the well-known, high-quality riders in this field. And they're, you know, this is already now, if you're going to do damage on this climb, this is where you do it.
Yeah, 6% gradient. Now we're about 2/3 of the way done here. You've got one more kick, and then it flattens out actually toward the end of it. You have to carry a whole lot of speed through. There's going to be a pack chasing him down, and they may be thinking, look, we can bring him back. This is going to, let's work together here. And I think Laverick at this point is saying, come on, if anybody is in there that can go with me, please do it now. And at 12% gradient, this is the steepest part here. Going through, it looks like the area where they took down all the trees here, actually. Look at this. We got a whole lot of lumber that's been chopped, and he's chopping wood for sure right now with these pedals hammering down one by one. He does each pedal stroke 384 watts right now. It's 6.5 watts per kilogram, but Friera is coming across, it looks like, but now backing off a little bit. It's like you're trying to kick each and every time for that little bit of extra speed to go across, and he does break a few of the riders off here. Some of these riders are still going to be dropping like fries.
Still, look at the numbers that Laverick is putting up on the board right now. The man is a wattage cottage. There's no doubt that they would have to be aware of how dangerous this is. But Nathan, that being said, a group with McGlinchey and company, Kirkmeyer, they don't have too much to worry about, to tell you the truth, because they know that they'll be able to collaborate and work. And there's a long way to go after they crest this climb. This is one of the wraps that you see in modern day Grand Tour cycling, is that it's so rare that you actually have summit finishes. Finishing at the top of the mountain. For many, many reasons in real life, it's a little bit different, obviously, here in the world on Watopia, in Innsbruck today in the world of Zwift. But Nathan, one thing's for sure, that the fact that they've got, 10, more than 10K after the climbing ends to the finish line really benefits the guys that are able to keep their powder dry, sit back in this group. Laverick is going to have to put some more coal on the fire, and he is. This man is phenomenal out of Wales. Look at this. We're going to be seeing almost 7 watts per kilo. Superstar Ed Laverick on the front, throwing more coal on the fire, hammer and tongs. This man is just banging out the watts, Nathan. He's going to do a lot of damage. Now, there's not going to be as many guys left in that chase group by the time it's all over. Here's Viva Mexico. This is Eder Freire. In real life, Legion LA is his team. He's going to have some company. It's Kirkmeyer racing in his virtual home, in his real life home country here in Austria. Then now, McGlinchey is coming. Nathan, it's a who's who on the front of this bike race right now.
This is the last kick up until it actually flattens out here. They probably have about a K to go, maybe a little less, to the top of the climb here. And this is the last chance to really break the group apart. And, you know, the motivation here at this point would be go across to Ed Laverick, get on his wheel, and then from there, separate yourself as much as you can from anybody who is unable to hang on at this point. This is make it or break it for anyone who's going to make the make pack at this point. And as you can see, they're still trying to do so. And it's good to see, because they could just sit in and get comfortable and just chase down Laverick. But if they want to break anybody off still at this point who's really suffering, they've got to turn the screws right now. Boniface here looks to be struggling. That's not something you usually see. Now 5.3 watts per kilogram, looking to come across 168 beats per minute. They're hot in there. Now it looks Barney ZA there coming out of New Zealand, trying to get across as well, does so. And the early aggressor, Pakzoko here from Team Zwift Poland. Now, off the back here. So it looks like Harold also from Team Experimental. So now this is going to be your top 13 riders, it looks like. Lucky number 13 for the pain out here today. It's Led Laverick now. He's going to come over the top, and he's going to be the KOM champion on the day. That's for sure. Very suiting for this rider here. 8 seconds, though. Kirchmer looking to go across. Will he do so? And I don't think he's going to do so before we actually hit the KOM at this point. And this is going to be a solid time. Like I said earlier on, coming in here with a little bit of motivation after having a couple of technical issues, I believe, over the weekend. He did, I think, three or four climbing races over the weekend, actually. So Laverick here now looking for some revenge. And he's doing it here out on the Innsbruck UCI short lap course.
Well, we always learn lessons out here on Zwift, and I'd have to say Pazopko now knows what it's like to get Lavericked. He is officially Lavericked out here because you go so hard in these races. I mean, they're still coming up on 20 minutes, but the reality of what it takes, I mean, look at this. Ed Laverick is still sitting right in that 7 watts per kilo. That's rarefied air for riders that can ride
going
in that zone.
At 8 watts per
kilo. Look at this.
Trying to come across. Oh,
it's probably going to pop red here. Well, I would think you're starting to see that Eder Freire showing, as you say, Nathan, popping red numbers up there. We're starting to see a little bit of that. But the reality is these guys have been way, way up there for a long time. Laverick up and over the top. Unbelievable. 15, here we
16.
Go.
This is insane. These guys are so motivated. McGlinchey looking to go across, and I thought it'd come over the top together, but instead we're seeing some separation here a little bit, but it's all going to come back together.
This should come back together. Yeah. Yeah,
it's pretty intense downhill here. It's like a negative, like I think 15% at some point. So it's gonna be very difficult to stick away. But and so Laverick here, he did his damage, but he's at 3.3 watts per kilogram. He knows they're coming on, and we've got a bike race here with this lead pack at this point, with 45 seconds back, a minute back to the next pack. This is going to be the lead group.
Can I just add, Nathan, it's not all over for Ed Laverick when he gets caught, because the difference in the effort that he made up to the top of that climb was not all that different, was it, than the guys who made it in this group? Everybody had to generate insane watts to get up and over the top. So, yeah, if you were able to sit back in this group, but the drafting advantage that you have when you're on a steep climb like that, you're going so much slower, is nowhere near as much. They make the catch of Laverick. Go ahead and hit that reset button. But, Nathan, I think you'd agree with me. Don't count Ed Laverick out in any way, shape or form. I've learned enough to believe that. Thank you, Dick. Hopefully they'll work that into the dictionary.
It is now a verb. You're getting Lavericked up over the top of these climbs. Whenever we hit these kinds of courses here, be on the watch out here. And now, interesting to see. Let's take a quick look here at our current GC standings again. As this is the situation. Mike Davis is not here. I believe Holden Commute has been dropped as well. Brian Hodges is not here. Stephen Kirchmeyer is here. George
is here. Yep.
It looks like is Hodges here with this group here? Has he made this lead group? I believe so.
Okay, well, good. Well, you are always better at that than I am.
I will double check and see if he's made it here, but I do not believe so. But Stephen Kirchmeyer has made it. I believe George Mills Keeling.
McGlinchey did.
McGlinchey has made it. Yep, and he is here as well. Brett Boniface is here as well. So I believe about three or four of the riders in the top 10 are actually here. We'll keep a lookout and see how things end up developing amongst this here. But, you know, at this point, the separation is exactly, and it's a GC standing. That's the thing. This is on time. It's not points, which I love to see a series like
this.
So
your
new
top three are in. Yeah, your new top three is in this group without any doubt.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I agree with you, Nathan. I love the way that they organize this 3R Wahoo series. Second of seven races. The courses are so varied. It doesn't suit anyone. Oh, boy, this is what you were talking about. This is good, pretty steep. Negative 13 right here. Nathan, I super tucked for the first time. Listening to your advice, I figured out how to do it. It's a cool feeling the first time your avatar responds the way you want it to. You get to have that experience as they are right now. Super Tuck, a nice aero advantage that they're
Boniface,
back on the gas.
What is he doing? We're on this downhill here. And Boniface is like, let's kick it on the 14% gradient downhill.
This is
working
insane.
With Brownland here, gets a gap, and they're using the Super Tuck along with the PTZ rider. But this can work. This can work. The reason being is because the Super Tuck with a kick into it here can make it so that you can split things apart, and that is dangerous. If you get somebody off the back, if you get someone off the back and they are not attached and it just barely opens up those meters, next thing you know, you have to be in full-on sprint mode for a solid half a K or something. So didn't work here, but it was close.
Well, you could catch some guys out. You make a really good point. It might not be a race-winning attack, but you could put some guys in trouble for a minute. There you go. Brett Boniface back on it again, flogging himself like a redded mule right now that's due back in 5 minutes. Reckless abandon. So Boniface is doing exactly what you're talking about. Interesting. This technique here, that is some high-level Zwifting. We've talked about how in esports, I mean, you have to have the engine to play the game. But when you get there, when you're comfortable operating over 6 watts per kilo and you can still operate your brain, you're not going completely hypoxic, and you can still make smart decisions out there in the way that you race and turn it into not just a physical slugfest, but a tactical battle as well. And clearly Brett Boniface operates, he's like a Jedi Knight of bike racers out here. Obviously so there's another guy. So I think we have four, Nathan, that
yeah,
we
I
have
didn't notice
up,
that Keenan had actually made it, but he has made it. So it does look like four of the top 10 in the GC have made it. So virtually these are your series leaders right now.
Good job, George.
That will be Stephen Kirchmer. It'll be George Mills Keeling. It'll be Christopher McGlinchey as well as Brett Boniface out here. And very cool to see how this is playing out here today. Now, that's just the top 10. I'm going to try and look back a little ways. I mean, with so many riders showing up in this series overall, we may be seeing a couple in the top 20 as well, because the way that last race finished, it definitely had a sprint to the line that was just pretty much all out, and with about 30, 40 riders. So there may be a few riders that are still within that 1 second that we are missing on this overall. Because I'm looking all the way back to the top 20 even, and there's still riders here. Now, we do have an attack here off the front, actually. Interesting to see. Laverick now going along with it. It looks like it's going to be Boniface again, just putting out the wattages here over and over. And Ed Laverick is actually only 2 seconds back from the lead there with Davis and Holden there, actually. So he's actually within – actually, the top 40 riders were all within 2 seconds of each other. So I believe the riders – James Barnes in here as well. He was at a 49.25 virtual lead here, it looks like. So a lot of these riders here, because of the reality of how far back that sprinter course goes, I think are going to be in here. But now Boniface now making his way to the front. He's going to be the virtual leader on course for
pretty
this
good
race
size
here.
Gap.
Yeah,
I mean,
7 seconds.
He doesn't have that far to the finish, Nathan. He's opened up, 7, 8, 9 seconds. Here you go, going huge. The chase is really going to start to activate right now. That looks like Ed Laverick here is going to start. Ed Laverick going to start making his move now. McGlinchey coming. So, all right, Brett Boniface has officially poked the bear at this point as they go into full chase mode. That is going to be in the red and black there. Christopher McGlinchey out of Northern Ireland, who's had some big wins already this last month. He's going to get some help. They start to collaborate here. The gap starting to come down, or it looks like it plateaued or peaked at about 10 seconds. Let's see, Nathan. Ed Laverick has been in the bank. He got all the money. He's in the getaway car, and now he is hightailing his way around Innsbruck.
Yeah, and I do see the questions coming on in, everybody. It is 24K, 24K total. We'll get some information on screen. 24K in total today. So it's going to be up and over the top of the leg snapper, through the sprint section, and boom to the finish line. It's pretty quick here, everybody. Leg snapper, really the section. From there, maybe a section.
That's it, right?
As it'll calm down, and then it'll be into that straightaway, and it's a very tactical play out here. Interesting to see how they're starting to play games with those orange numbers, these little kicks here and there. These riders are all going to be very tired at this point. A lot of energy has been snapped out of their legs, and this is going to be a little bit of attrition if they do continue to attack. Leg snapper may make some deciding moves if anybody's really hurting at this point.
And it's coming up pretty quickly here, Nathan. In the world of Zwift, you'd call this a berg, wouldn't you? A very short, steep climb. It's really a little bit steeper than anything. Well, there's been a couple sectors that they saw that approached this, but it's very steep, not all that long. A few guys will get shown the back door here in this group during that. I'm going to say it's about a two-minute effort, Nathan, but it's an all-out two-minute effort. Almost, I mean, that's where the race is going to be won or lost. Now, if you've made this selection, good for you. You've got one real test ahead of you. You know who looks like he's feeling great today is obviously Brett Boniface. He's sitting there in the green jersey, the Canadian rider. Time to Canuck up, Brett. Let's see if you've got it today. Kirkmeyer, though, I'm going to go with him as my favorite today, Nathan. He's been sitting up there every single time we've seen climbing courses. He's been exceptional. Maybe it's his day on his virtual in real or his virtual home here in Austria.
Yeah, we do see it looks like making the way to the front, though. It's going to be Barney looks like now James Barn to the front, Twitch TV. He's actually streaming as well, I believe. Maybe putting on a show there for a few of his viewers. It's good to see Barney out there hammering away out of New Zealand. I believe he was a former national champion of Zwift, but the level has come up very high with these verified badges to the front. Vitus Pro Cycling now with Christopher Glinsky here. This has been the rider on courses like this. I would have said early on that he was a favorite, and McGlinsky here hammering now,
100%.
10 watts per kilogram now. Because of the climbing and the kind of sting in the legs, McGlinchey also has a solid sprint, and I think he's the rider that kind of has that all-around aces to be played out here today. Brandlin, though, following it up. George McKillian still on the wheel, it looks like. Nobody really falling off too much. S. Breyer actually here just hanging on. Eddie Freire falls off the wheel. That is game over. Cannot come back. No way with the kind of speeds that are going to be. Maybe, well, 8 watts per kilogram, but 4 seconds, this kind of speed, 67 kilometers per hour. Some of these riders are just hanging on at this point.
Oh boy, Edder might have had a little power drop out there because he was riding extremely well. Very surprised to see that. Let's hope the Mexican can rejoin the group here as we take a look at the front. Oh boy, it is on now. So they neutralized that move from McGlinchey. There's the Irish flag that we see. Who's going to be a hero today? Who wants it more? Because only one man gets to lick his plate clean here. Such a select group. I mean, if you're in this group, clearly you are one of the best climbers in the Zwift world. world right now. Boy, that Austrian flag keeps popping. We're at 3 kilometers to go, and it's all flat now, Nathan. There's nowhere to hide in this group. Racing out of a let's call this a 13, 14 rider group. Really, really tricky. There's no team tactics that I'm aware of, Nathan. Maybe you know something I don't, but I think it's every man for himself here. As you, I think you're seeing almost 14 different nations basically being represented. It's a rolling UN. Let's hope they get along better.
Interesting to see. Yeah, that's a good point. There really isn't anybody to work together with here. Every team has been kind of represented. The only team that hasn't made this, actually, it looks like that as I've mentioned, is going to be Cyrus the Pros Closet, actually. Interesting to see. Look, Boniface now kicking. You know why Boniface is kicking? He sees Eddie Ferrer coming back on, and he does not want to sprint with the Legion rider. Maybe just looking for the sprint section. We'll have to see. Kirkmeyer now going across here. More there now from PTZ. It looks like Laverick now, 9.8 watts per kilogram. Interesting. Now, Laverick, this is not the situation that he necessarily wants. He doesn't have a serious kick compared to the rest of the riders. You'll see high watts per kilogram for him, but just like in real life, pure wattage matters more in a sprint out on Zwift. Boniface and Kirkmeyer, they get the gap here. Brandlin looking to go across. They're going to let Brandlin do the work, I think, here. And 7-8 watts per kilogram, looking to jump back on. McGlinchey playing it very smart, it looks like, believing this is going to be brought back in. And it looks like the riders who are to get the most benefit at this point, it's going to be McGlinchey and Barney ZA, I believe, here, as Barney and him sat in, got the benefit, 175 beats per minute, looking to get the watts to come down as we head into the final K. 1K to go, 1K to go from here.
Well, Nathan, you make a great point. When you talk about the guy that can make 8 watts per well, or let's go realistic, 6.5 watts per kilo for 20 minutes, that's a different guy than the one who can make 15 watts per kilo for 10 seconds. And it's going to be the ladder rider, the guy that can throw the huge numbers up on the board that's going to win out of this group. I mean, Brett Boniface can sprint, that's for sure. Clearly, they don't want Edda Freer back in this group, because if he arrives, he definitely is on pit. Well, let's not forget about Christopher McGlinchey, right, Nathan? He's got a real wide range of skills, let's say, when you talk about the Irish rider. Okay, the attacks are inevitable. Laverick, you knew. So, Nathan, if you don't think you can win in the sprint, what do? You channel your inner Jens Voigt here.
This might work.
This might. Who's joining? It's going to be coming, isn't it? It's going to be the British rider coming. United Kingdom in full effect right now, Nathan. I'm going to throw it to you. You always know these finishes better than me.
Laverick here now, 176 beats per minute, 488 watts, 8.3 watts per kilogram, just driving the pace. Coming here now, 11 watts per kilogram now, more trying to come across. Coming now, gets the jump. He got the lead out there from Laverick, set him up perfectly, 10 watts per kilogram. Will they be able to close down 3 seconds at this point? Boniface there, 14, 16 watts per kilogram coming from Brett Boniface. Boniface looking to maybe come across. Looks like Brett Boniface is going to be making it happen. Moore is right on his wheel, though. The PTZ rider, looks like the PTZ rider, Christopher Glitzky, can he come over the top? Will he make it happen? It's right to the line, and it looks like maybe McGlinchey. No, Brandlin, I believe. Samuel Brandlin taking it down. What a kick there from Brandlin. I believe it was Brandlin. It was 4 to the line there. And, you know, the back end API isn't going to lie, everybody. So we'll have to wait and see. On screen, it looked like Brandlin might have taken it down. We'll take a look at the replay here in just a moment. What a kick to the line. I've got 2 different views. I got McGlinchey's view as well.
I think you got it right, Nathan. I'm 99% sure that was Samuel Brandlin, the Swedish rider here, expecting that last little surge from McGlinchey that never quite came. They certainly took the sting out of the legs there as we... Okay. There you go. Thanks, Nathan. So this was what looked like a race-winning move, as they so often do, Nathan. But not quite.
But it looks like not quite going to happen here. Here comes Boniface and the rest of the group. Moore leading it out up in that 17 watts per kilogram. Boniface there fading to the line, it looks like. McGlinchey was right on his wheel. And I think I have actually another view here as McGlinchey is trying to come through. It's really interesting.
Maybe Boniface.
Boniface holding, it looks like.
This is a photo finish.
It is a photo finish here. Let's go ahead. We have another view here, actually, of this exact same sprint.
You know, I'm gonna go ahead and I was sure you were right. Here. I thought Samuel had it too, Nathan, but in watching that slow-mo, Boniface here, the Canadian who had attacked multiple times throughout the race, at this
right. Oh, I,
wow. Boniface got it.
Too close to
I'm
call
calling
there.
That for the green jersey, the jersey on the far end of the camera there. He had it, if you ask me. That's amazing. I love this sport
Miglitsky,
so much.
How did he do it? Miglitsky ends up second there. Boniface takes it, though, but I didn't think Miglitsky, Brandlin, right to the line. And the back end API is saying that it's Miglitsky comes through over the top there, everybody. Brandlin, wow. Lewis Moore, Stephen Kirchmer, Sebastian Breyer, wow, James Barnes followed up.
What now, a race.
Amazing
what a race,
race all around. All around. Now, you look know,
they
at
always
Stephen Kirchmer
about...
actually a full second back there. Interesting to see.
Will they split that sprint? Is it normally? Or I mean, you can see when they're going that hard that gaps open up. I am stunned to see McGlinchey got up there for second with no bonuses or anything. We've got a very interesting GC battle to watch now. So Brett Boniface, congratulations. That man makes the race. That's La Roica. That's the hero standard. Attacking a couple of times, getting caught, coming back, and holding on. And, you know, he was not in a winning position, it looked like to me, in that sprint, Nathan. I thought McGlinchey had the perfect ride there. At about 150 meters to go, he was in the slipstream at you know, full gallop. But
yeah,
Brett
I thought
Boniface,
I did. I was with you there. I actually thought he was going to come through. Because of the way that he drafted there, getting cagey rider here, getting very experienced, obviously, in
right
the
spot,
world
right
of
time.
Swift racing. That's for sure. Yeah, that is for sure. Just so I do see some comments coming on through, everybody. And so I just want to, this is esports. And for those that are unfamiliar with esports, in some of the ways that they do work, because we are virtual, things go to servers and then they come back. And so some of the things that we might see on broadcast are not maybe exactly where the riders are pinging to each other, right? So the avatars are pinging their information to the servers, and then it's pinging back to all the rest of the riders about where everybody's positioned at any time. And so the backend API don't lie when it comes to the pure power for who actually got their avatar first to the line. That's the reason why you might have seen something a little bit different on our end. But McGlinchey was first across the line when it comes to the timing and across that finish. Well, not first across the line, but second across the line compared to Brandlin. Because I know everybody saw that Brandlin was right there neck and neck with Boniface. But just a little bit difference there, it looks like, between us and the servers. Just as a quick explanation, guys.
I guess in the nerd community, Nathan, I think I could sell the backend API don't lie.
That's exactly what it is. That's actually, you know, that I think I coined that one about a year ago, and I think that's the first. That might be one of the first merch that ZCL is coming out with. Just so everybody knows, one of the first. I think that somebody flogging themselves like a Reddit mule might be one too. We'll have to wait and see how that plays out, guys.
That's up to the marketing department, I think. Yeah. great race again today. That's for sure. I have learned a lot, Nathan. Just going back to what you were talking about, is you really picking up what's happening out there and learning the nuances of the racing. It's all part of the fun. And I'll admit, I'm still learning as I go too. As I throw it to you for those finishes, it is that's one of the challenges. Definitely is just learning the course, becoming experienced, and that's the value of engaging with something. Is the more you know, the more you want to know, but it also makes things more fun out there. It's been quite a journey over the last 5 years with Zwift, and it just gets better and better.
Looking through a lot of the comments coming on through, got to see a lot of the racers actually that were a part of the race here. McGlinchey saying, "Ha, hanging on over the climb, then tried to drop faster guys in the snapper, didn't work." And he did use a lot of energy there. Yeah, he used a ton of energy there. Good to see.
Yeah, he needed 15. 15 more watts when McGlinchey comes through for that win, you know, and those watts were burnt. Yeah, yeah.
Looking at the time gaps here, I mean, we're looking at 6/1000ths of a second. I mean, that's nothing. That's pretty much nothing. 5/100ths of a second there between first and second, and then between Brandlin and McGlinchey there, even less there. So, I mean, really, really cool. 150 watts. Feels like an FTP test, James Joseph Barnes is saying as well. And he was in that last top 10. What an elite group we saw there. Laverick, Maverick was the man on the hill climb, setting almost a 15 flat. Absolutely amazing, but it wasn't about that in the end. It was still, you know, like you said, like those World Tour stages where it's a mountaintop, but then you come into these towns and sprint finishes a lot of times end up playing out if you can't get away, and that's what ended up happening. There was a solid effort there by Laverick. He gave that last-ditch effort, you know, with almost 800 meters to go. Ended up setting up Cuming, but didn't end up happening there, and it does end up with Brett Boniface, Christian Mugenchi, Sam O'Brien. That's your top three today, everybody, in the 3-hour ride reel, 3-hour racing series. Just so everybody knows, if you jump into the series, there are some giveaways happening here with Wahoo. So lots of opportunity. Still have 5 races to go. It's a 7-race series for all the categories, A, B, C, and D. Next up on Zwift Community Live, tomorrow we've got USA Cycling Series. Big race tomorrow. Going to be a lot of fun. I'm doing the USA Cycling Series in the evenings. If you haven't done it, they're amazing courses. Fast, furious. Also happening this weekend, Beyond the Watch Out, we have the Tour of Gila. Dave, you're very familiar with that race in real life.
Oh, I love it. It's and I'm really happy to see that you're really dovetailing everything together as the WTRL, the World Tactical Racing League. They do such a great job with the team time trials every Thursday. So they're still having their event, but because they're helping us. And how cool is that, that Martin and Steven are jumping in to be a part of that team to make the Tour of the Gila happen. So for Jack Brennan down there in Silver City, New Mexico, go ahead and get your green chili out if you're going to be watching for the racers. Brace yourself. It's going to be 3 awesome days, team time trial, circuit, and then the Gila Monster. Now, we're going to try to replicate, Nathan, one of the greatest days of racing in American history is this event. Tour of the Gila goes back to 1986. This year it's virtual, and I appreciate you helping make that happen. It's extremely cool for our racers. I saw Crystal Doble Hickok talking about her excitement for this event. Nathan, the stoke level is off the charts.
Yeah, it's going to be absolutely awesome. A lot of fun this weekend here. And I think it's going to be a lot of suffering. We've got a team time trial on Friday. We've got a circuit race on Saturday. And then we've got the Queen of the Mountain stage race on the Medio Fondo. So pretty cool racing this weekend with the Tour of Gila. Real quickly, guys, if you didn't see it, we did post the race schedule. So you can go ahead and check that out over on all of our socials. Real easy to find over at Zwift Community Live. Check out the Facebook. Here's also the schedule for the week for those of you who might be wondering. So today, obviously, being the start of the week, every Tuesday is how we start our racing. Wednesday, obviously, USA Cycling. Coast Sports is taking over on Thursday. Check them out. And then Gila all weekend long. So that's what's happening for this week of streaming out on ZCL. All right, everybody. Nathan Guerra. This is Dave Toll. That was a great race for 3R. And we will see you tomorrow for the USA Cycling series that's going on. As always, everybody, thanks a lot to the viewers. Hit and great job to the racers. And ride on.